हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस सर।
हेलो, ओके। रेस्पेक्टेड सीमा मैम, विद्युत सर, सफी मोहन सर, एलजीआर ऑफ स्टेट एंड ट्रिवेंद्रम चैप्टर ऑफिशियल्स, एलजीआर ऑफ मेंबर्स एंड ऑल दोस हु आर प्रेजेंटेड हियर इन दिस वेबिनार, आई विश यू ऑल अ हैप्पी रिपब्लिक डे एंड अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग। This day has come to mean a lot to all Indians living within the country and abroad. In 1950, on this very day, we, the people of India, adopted, enacted, and gave to ourselves a unique constitution. This is the day for each and every Indian citizen to halt and ruminate over the core values that the constitution propounds. These values, justice, liberty, equality, and fraternity, outlined in the preamble of our constitution, are sacred to all of us. Its abiding adherence is meant not only for those who are mandated to govern, but for the people at large. Keeping this vision in mind, LJRF has decided to conduct the Ambedkar Memorial Lecture Series in order to disseminate and uphold the consecrated values envisaged in our Constitution and also to discuss and ponder the noble values put forward by this distinguished visionary. As planned, we, LJRF Trivandrum chapter, will conduct a total of 5 lectures as part of the Ambedkar Memorial Lecture Series in association with the Mandava Science Foundation and Hindustan Institute of Technology and Science. So, we are about to start the second lecture of the Ambedkar Lecture Series in this memorable day. To start over the proceedings, I invite Mr. David Varghese, student, Government Law College, Trivandrum. And it's over to you, David.
Thank you so much, sir. We must recognize the fundamental rights of man. There can be no true national life in our democracy unless we give unqualified recognition to freedom of religious worship and freedom of education. These were the words of Franklin D. Roosevelt. Good afternoon and happy Republic Day to all the participants and dignitaries. I am David Varghese Thomas, fourth year law student at Government Law College, Trivandrum, and an intern at the Law and Justice Research Foundation. It is my privilege to be comparing the second session of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Memorial Lecture Series as part of the Republic Day celebrations. And I'm thankful for the organization for giving me this opportunity. Today's session is on the topic Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in the Making of Fundamental Rights. I would take a moment to appreciate our conductors, LJRF Trivandrum Chapter, in collaboration with Mandava Science Foundation Bangalore and Hindustan Institute of Technology and Science Chennai. I welcome all the dignitaries and everyone else who have taken the time from their busy lives to attend this schedule. This is session. Before we get started, I would like to remind all the participants to mute themselves and to not start any presentations during the lecture for the smooth conduct of the session. Now, I would like to invite Advocate Neelima V. Nair, Joint Secretary, LJRF Trivandrum Chapter and Guest Lecturer at Government Law College, Trivandrum, to officially welcome the participants. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, David. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible.
Yes, ma'am. Audible.
A very warm good evening to one and all. This is the second webinar conducted by Law and Justice Research Foundation, Trivandrum Chapter, in collaboration with the Mandava Science Foundation, Bangalore, and Hindustan Institute of Technology and Science, Chennai, as a part of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Memorial Lecture Series. Today's topic is Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in the Making of Fundamental Rights, and we have with us some eminent speakers who will give a deep insight into the topic. First of all, I cordially welcome Sri Vidyut K.S., Assistant Professor, Government Law College, Kozhikode. He is a familiar face in the LJRF programs and also a great speaker. We are pleased to have your valuable presence, sir. Welcome, sir. Now, I welcome our keynote speaker for today's webinar, Dr. P.S. Seema, former director and associate professor, School of Legal Studies, CUSAT. I extend a hearty welcome.
Thank you.
Next, I would like to welcome the renowned and most respected Dr. Mani Venkat Lakshman, Dean, School of Law at Hindustan Institute of Technology and Science, to this program. A hearty welcome, sir. Sri Daniel Prashant Sebastian, Managing Trustee, Mandava Science Foundation, is a closely associated person and a constant support to the LJRF family. I affectionately welcome you, sir, to this program. Next, I welcome
Thank you.
Ms. Aarti. Okay, sir. Next, I welcome Ms. Amina Assam, the talented and active member of LJRF Trivandrum chapter, who will be delivering the word of thanks today. Welcome, Amina. And finally, with utmost pleasure, I welcome all my friends, officials, and members of Law and Justice Research Foundation, and also the participants of this webinar. Welcome, dear all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. That was indeed a pleasant welcome. Up next, I would like to invite Sri Vidyut K.S., Assistant Professor in Law, Government Law College, Kozhikode, to give the presidential address.
Vidyut, please unmute. Vidyut, please unmute.
Thank you, ma'am. A very good evening to you all. I'm very happy to be part of this session for more than certain reasons, for two, three reasons. And I'm very happy to be part of this because today's keynote speaker is my own research guide and also my own teacher. And I had been a fan of her, not only because of her excellent teaching skills, but she's also a very good singer, I must tell you. And the way she presents herself as a teacher is very attractive in the sense that, you know, she's very friendly with the students, and she's also, you know, delivers certain excellent jokes, you know, which is a quality of a teacher, I would say. It is not like a very serious kind of a, you know, teaching method she adopts. So that is one reason why I'm so happy to be here. Second reason is that this is a lecture on Ambedkar, whom I respect so much. And I'll just try to give a very few introductory remarks on Dr. Ambedkar in making. Dr. Ambedkar in the making of fundamental rights as the topic of today's lecture. When we think about Ambedkar, or when we organize a lecture series on Ambedkar, we must say that it is very, very important politically, socially, and culturally. An institution of LJRF significance, organizing a lecture series would contribute in many ways in keeping Dr. Baba Saheb Ambedkar, B.R. Ambedkar, in the memory of our society, and keeping in the memory of our social psyche of a society is very much important when there is an attempt on the other side to deliberately forget that person because of his contributions for the upliftment of the deprived classes of people in the society. So it is this function of keeping Ambedkar in memory, which is very significant. And second one associated with it, it creates an interest in Ambedkar, in knowing Ambedkar. So when a lecture series is being organized and Ambedkar is talked about, it would definitely create an interest. Many people who won't be knowing Ambedkar after hearing, it would cause an interest in Ambedkar, and they'll try their level best to understand whether whatever is being said is right or not, or what is his significance. And this search would definitely would show him what is the value of this person, what are his contributions, what are the ideas that he advanced, and what is that would make him a valuable person as far as Indian society is concerned, or even the world at large. And third, this kind of activities would defend, as I said, it would defend acts of attacking through silence. I don't need to introduce Ambedkar, his biographical account, because you all know, and you also have conducted another lecture series early. So Ambedkarian biographical account might have been given, we assume. But as you all know, when Ambedkar was trying to deliver a lecture on annihilation of caste, the organizers themselves who have invited Ambedkar for delivering lecture on the topic annihilation of caste cancelled that meeting only because of the content of his speech. He was talking against the nonsensical or unjust aspects of Hindu religion, and he was arguing for reformation based on cardinal changes in the Hindu religious practices. However, Ambedkar has published that particular speech in printed form and he has circulated. There was no response to such written document thereafter, because it was a strategy. It was a strategy to keep him or put him in silence without responding him, so that his ideas won't get much circulation in society. This strategy is still going on, and ideas from a different perspective would be attacked through silence, and silence is the best strategy. So this kind of lecture series could break such strategies and can be contributing to the dissemination of ideas which Ambedkar wants to disseminate in the society as a whole. So second aspect I would like to emphasize is the significance of Ambedkarian remembrance. So through lecture series, if we are remembering Ambedkar, and if we try to correlate Ambedkar with certain of his contributions, what is the significance of it? First, it reinstates those values which Ambedkar wants to be the foundation of social organization or social reorganization, we would say. And he has been instrumental in incorporating those values in the constitution. It is very clear if you go through Constituent Assembly debates. There are many speeches which is very significant for understanding what was the processes behind the scenes in the making of Constitution. So it brings to the public those values and its importance when we remember Ambedkar, because Ambedkar is closely associated with those values like liberty, equality, and fraternity. We had a social organization where liberty, equality, and fraternity were no more. We had a society where suppression, oppression, caste suppression and caste oppression, inequality, no liberty. The private life of an individual has been designed, or it has been shaped through a lot many restrictions imposed from outside. And the privacy or the private field of the individuals were literally lacking. So it was in such a society, the designing of the constitution occurred. And the constitution sought for a reorganization of society or restructuring of a society in which the values of liberty, equality, and fraternity should be there. So it is where here Ambedkar has contributed, and how that process you need to unearth through this lecture series. Second is that it creates confidence among the marginalized people and the oppressed people, because one of their leaders, I must say, though he should not be considered to be the representative of only oppressed and marginalized classes, because he is a universal pan-Indian figure, he should be. But still then being one of their representatives, it will create confidence in those people who consider him to be one among them. And third one, it gives due, it attributes due respect in a befitting manner on such a person as Ambedkar. As I said, which is now being tried from many angles through the strategy of silence, to not to respond. And the third one is, what are the contributions of Ambedkar? And here we are focusing on Ambedkar and the making of fundamental rights as a part of constitution, and how Ambedkar might have contributed for this. Definitely, Seema teacher is the right person to talk on that. She has years of experience and in teaching as well as research in constitutional law. And she's a very nice person who would be sharing her ideas as well as experience on that topic. And I would just like to give a suggestion that Ambedkarian contribution has to be discussed by focusing on different aspects of the constitution wherein he contributed, as well as different aspects of the social life in which he has contributed. Like, he is instrumental in bringing so many changes in labor law, like minimization of working hours, payment of gratuity, for example. And he has been instrumental in bringing in women right movement in India, along with others, and children's rights. And he has written extensively on different subjects, including political science, economics, sociology, anthropology, and religion. And he was a multi-talented person, well-versed in different disciplines, which enabled him to give qualitative contribution for the designing of our constitution. So with this, I am stopping. So I would like to welcome Seema teacher to the session. And I am also eagerly waiting for what she has to say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the valuable words. It is my honor to invite our keynote speaker for the day, Dr. P.S. Seema, former director and associate professor, School of Legal Studies, KUSAD. I wholeheartedly welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Bye, my friend. The Prime Minister of Bihar, who spoke yesterday, he said, how can this resolution prevent the need from coming into the Constituent Assembly?
That was Ambedkar's voice.
Dr. Shyam Prasad Mukherjee asked another question. Is this resolution inconsistent with the cabinet vision proposal? No, sir. I think they were very important questions. And they I think, ought to be answered. And answered categorically.
That was Ambedkar's voice. I thought we will start hearing from him, his voice. So we'll start Dr. Ambedkar in the making of the fundamental rights. In fact, when I was asked to say something about Dr. Ambedkar, I thought I will talk something about how dominant he was in the Constituent Assembly debates. Because I had conducted a mock Constituent Assembly debate in my constitutional class which is actually an elective on Article 21 alone. And then I had asked the students to play the roles of those who participated in the Constituent Assembly debates. And they assumed the roles of respective persons, and then they delivered the sum and substance of the speech. And what we could find is that, in fact, out of 13 or 14 members who took part in the discussion of Article 21, except two persons, that is K.M. Munshi and I think it was Zari, except these two persons, everyone was of the view that instead of the word procedure established by law, the word due process should be added in Article 21. And they had very solid reasons for arguing for including the word due process instead of procedure established by law. And you are all aware of the fact that Article 21 is like this: no person shall be deprived of his life or personal liberty except according to procedure established by law. This means that if there is a procedure established by law, then a person's life or liberty can be curtailed. It can also mean that if there is a procedure, that is the end of the matter. That is, nobody can look into whether that procedure is right, whether the procedure is fair, or whether the procedure is just. So that is the fear of the members. That is, if the state wants, like if the legislature wants to have a draconian law, what they need to have is only making a law. That means they don't need to make a fair, just, reasonable law. And they advocated for the word due process, that is in the US Constitution. They said that let the judges have a freedom to interpret the procedure in the light of fairness, justness, and reasonableness. So that was, and if you look at the Constituent Assembly debate, all of them had very well-reasoned arguments for arguing for the word due process, and the vast majority were in support of the word due process. But we find finally the word procedure established by law as was suggested by the drafting amendment. That means it was the same. That means the amendments were not accepted. The reason is that everyone was discussing. It was a heated debate. Finally, Dr. Ambedkar came and he said just two paragraphs. I mean, when you look at the printed form, you can find paragraphs. Just two, three paragraphs. He said, "I don't know. I don't know whether we should go for the procedure established by law where you give the power to the parliament, or we should go by the word due process where you give the power to the judges, which is better because the parliamentarians are supposed to be the reflection of the will of the people, and they consume a lot of time for making a legislation. Let us believe them." But of course, there can be political motives which can make the law oppressive of the weaker persons or oppressive of the opponents. They can do that. But if you go by the word due process and give the judges the ultimate power, it is like giving the power to just two, three persons. Maybe that a single judge or a division bench can annul a particular legislation which was made out of laborious task of different persons. So many people were involved in making the law, and just two judges sitting and saying that this is unconstitutional. Should you give that power to the judge? And he said that I can't weigh between these two advantages and disadvantages. And he said, let us move ahead with the present form itself. And that was the end of the matter. And you find throughout the Constituent Assembly debate the dominance that was shown by Ambedkar, not because of his arrogance, but because of the intellectual depth he had. And it is, you know, I'll be showing it in my slides, his answers to the challenges that were made to the Constitution in various respects. And actually, it was like from every nook and corner, the Constitution was criticized like anything. But the way he gave his answers, and you were hearing his voice. Look at his voice, the assertive voice. And perhaps when he says something, if you read the Constituent Assembly debates, when he says something, whatever might have been the argument of the other party, however convincing the argument was, when Ambedkar stands and he says, everything stops there. It's not that he shut the mouth of the people. It was not muscle power. It was, you know, just the convincing way he was talking. So we will start with the next slide. This is a constitutional, image of a constitution of India. Now, this is one, the method which the Constituent Assembly adopted in connection with the Constitution. Just as I was told that these lectures are also for creating a constitutional awareness or constitutional literacy. When I was going through the historical materials connected with the Constitution of India, I was taken aback because it will take years and years for a person to master all that. But I have taken pain to see that something which is of our use, just that I have referred, because it is maybe that if a person is given a course on the history of constitution from a law student's perspective, I think it will be a good course for a 6 months course, because it will take even at least that much time for understanding the laborious task that went behind making the constitution. Actually, the first was to lay down its terms of reference, as it were, in the form of an objective resolution, and which was moved by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru in an inspiring speech. And actually, I have taken this from the Constituent Assembly debate itself. These are all narrated by the members in the Constituent Assembly when it just started. It then proceeded to appoint a number of committees to deal with different aspects of the constitutional problem. Several of these had their chairman, either as Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, etc. Then they all worked in a business-like manner and produced reports which were considered by the assembly, and their recommendations were adopted on the basis of which draft of the constitution had to be prepared. This was done by Mr. B.N. Rao, who brought to bear on his task a detailed knowledge of constitutions of other countries and an extensive knowledge of the conditions of this country as well as his own. That is, we will note that Dr. Ambedkar himself is thanking Mr. B.N. Rao for giving him a lot of assistance in the form of, you know, they had given something to the drafting committee and they worked on that. And we find when we move, this is the earlier slide was also from the speech of the president of the Constituent Assembly debate. And the third step was the assembly then appointed the drafting committee, which worked on the original draft prepared by Mr. B.N. Rao and produced the draft constitution, which was considered by the assembly. As Dr. Ambedkar pointed out, there were more than 7,635 amendments, of which 2,000 etc. were moved. I'm mentioning this only to show that it was not only the members of the drafting committee who were, this is actually the presidential address, who were giving their close attention to the constitution, but other members were vigilant and scrutinizing the draft in all its detail. No wonder that we had to consider not only each article in the draft, but practically every sentence and sometimes every word in very article. That was the pains that were taken by the constitution makers. Now let us see, you are all aware of these things, but I just wanted to refresh your memory on this. That is, when you look at our constitution, it is the biggest constitution in the world. The reason, of course, is that as Ambedkar himself puts it, he says that so many administrative factors are given in the constitution, which other countries do not do. So many things like the administration, the legislative powers, so many things in other countries, what they do is they put it in their legislations, not in the constitution. That is why we have a big constitution. And Dr. Ambedkar defends it also, saying that if it is a part of the constitution, then it has a power in itself. And then it is going to be definitely respected. That is what is expected. And we will see that the parliamentary government, rule of law, legislative procedure, the single citizenship, cabinet system, prerogative writs, parliamentary privileges and bicameralism, these were all taken from the British constitution. And then we will understand that how many constitutions were referred. It is said that 60 constitutions were referred by Ambedkar. before drafting this constitution. And actually there was an attack, and someone was saying also in a speech, I don't want to mention his name, he said that our constitution it's emotional. I think all can follow Malayalam. What he said was that constitution mottathil emotional. Okay, the same criticism was raised in the Constituent Assembly, and look at the way Ambedkar reacts to that. I will be coming to that in very few seconds. So features from other constitution: from Ireland, we have taken the directive principles of state policy, method of election of the president, members' nomination to the Rajya Sabha by the president. From United States, we have taken the impeachment of the president, functions of president and vice president, removal of Supreme Court, High Court judges, fundamental rights we have taken from the US Act. That is why I put it, I have highlighted it, because it is taken from, though it is taken from the US constitution, definitely it is not just a copy paste, you know, fundamentally there are a lot of differences. That is why we can't say it is just a copy. Then judicial review, independence of judiciary, these are all from the United States, and even the preamble of the constitution, these are from the United States. I think you are aware of all these, because the beginning of the constitution, learning of the constitution starts from this, that is from where we have taken. From Canada, the centrifugal form of federalism, where the center is stronger than the states. Residuary powers vest with the center. That feature is taken from the Canadian constitution. Center appoints the governors of the states, advisory jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. Then Australia, the concept of concurrent list, joint sitting of the two houses, freedom of trade and commerce from also from Australia. Then Australia's are the fundamental duties, the ideas of justice, social, economic and political expressed in the preamble. And France, the concept of republic, ideals of liberty, equality and fraternity contained in the preamble. There, and of course France has a history of fighting against oppression through French Revolution. So these concepts are taken from the France. The features, Germany, fundamental rights are suspended during emergency. From South Africa, we have taken election of members of the Rajya Sabha, amendment of the constitution. In Japan, the concept of procedure established by law. Then we find, even though fundamental rights are taken from the US constitution, in our article 21, we have not taken the word from the US constitution, which is due process. Actually, that word procedure established by law is taken from the Japan constitution. That means even in fundamental rights, some concept was taken from the Japanese constitution. That reason is that, and I think I don't need to tell you the reason. He himself is going to tell you the reason why all these things are like this. Now, the Constituent Assembly adopted constitution on 26 November 1949, and the constitution came into force in 26 November 1950. The Constituent Assembly of India first met on 9th December 1946 and continued till 24 January 1950. And all these assembly debates are available in net, and Vidyut sir may be knowing that it is available in our library in printed form as well. Now, we are remembering him today because as Vidyut sir said, he was a multi-faceted personality. Because I was reading one article, I mean, rather it was a lecture in a symposium that was on caste. If possible, I will show you at least some part of that. I was taken aback because he was talking about the scientific basis of caste in that lecture. And he was trying to say that caste has no scientific basis at all, because he was giving a lot of examples of eugenics. And if eugenics, like white people do not want to mix with others, is to preserve the purity of the caste. If that is the reason, and if you call it a eugenics, scientifically, is it true? And he has given wonderful, and actually very tough to understand. And it looks like he's a master of anthropology. And it is like very difficult to perceive certain things which he was talking about. So scientific an explanation to say that caste is just an artificial creation, and it has nothing to do with science or any reasons which the promoters of caste say they are all baseless. I will show you that page if in between it is possible. I just said that because Vidyut sir was saying that he was a magnificent personality. He was having his hand on many things, and in that paper it was very interesting to see that he's saying Satya system, girl-child marriage, and widows are not allowed to marry again. All these are politics of the religions. And they say that once a woman is widowed, she shouldn't live in the society because she may marry someone from outside and may pollute their caste. So she should be get rid of. And that is why they found a method called the custom of sati. That is what he says. That is what he actually appeals to. And also he's talking about division of labor as that is one of the reasons given for caste system, as a justification for caste system, division of labor, which is even accepted in the modern society. And look at the way he reacts to that. That is given in Annihilation of Caste. In that book, and that actually Vidyut sir was pointing out that Annihilation of Caste is also available in the net. If possible, you must read that, because actually it was just a wonderful narration of how to, you know, realize something that is happening in the name of caste. The violences that are happening, not just physical violence, but the kind of human beings treating other human beings without any value. As a human rights teacher, I feel that if a person cannot look at the other human being as a human being, then whatever the person has, perhaps it is of no use. And he says, I like the religion that teaches liberty, equality, and fraternity. Life should be great rather than long. So let us remember him in today and move ahead. Now, what he has said, something which actually struck me, I quote him. Now, the question that I would like to ask is, it is written in his book, and Vidyut sir said, he was invited to talk on this topic, and he was not invited because they wanted him to remove some part from this this paper. He said, I won't change even a comma. And then, of course, he was not invited, and he published it otherwise. And something which I thought I will quote in the context of constitution, especially when we talk about Article 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. These are all about equality. So what perhaps went into the mind of Dr. Ambedkar while drafting these articles are all because of his own personal experience, and also the experience of others which he was seeing and which he was protesting very much. Now, the question that I would like to ask is it enough for a socialist to say, because it was in the context of someone saying socialism, I believe in perfect equality in the treatment of the various classes, is it enough to say that such a belief is enough, is to disclose a complete lack of understanding of what is involved in socialism? Especially this is very important because our republic is a socialist republic also. So in interpreting the word socialism in the preamble, our judges have fallen back on something in the Constituent Assembly debates. But I think they could have also fallen back on Ambedkar's Annihilation of Caste or some thoughts which Ambedkar was holding on this subject. If socialism is a practical program and is not merely an ideal, distant and far off, the question for a socialist is not whether he believes in equality. The question for him is whether he minds as a matter of principle, and thus allow tyranny and oppression to continue to divide one class from another. So his understanding of socialism is that as long as people believe that they can oppress somebody else and yet they can think of equality, it can be said as a self-negation, rather a hypocrisy. So that is what he was talking about in the annihilation of caste. And now this is the members of the drafting committee with Ambedkar and other members. Ambedkar on caste system. Again, it is in the annihilation of caste. A tree should be judged by the fruits it yields. If caste is eugenic, this is where he is explaining the scientific, or rather a lack of scientific explanation for caste. If caste is eugenic, what sort of a race of men should it have produced? Because he says that if caste is eugenic, every Hindu in India should have been of high profile physically, because if they could, what he says is, I think he's coming to it later. What he says is the eugenics means the mating between very efficient and very healthy people, avoiding all the disabled or intellectually low people, and then to have a very strong, more intellectual, more healthy new generation. That is what is meant by eugenics. But what he says is that if that is eugenics, all persons who are in the shell of their caste should have been physically fit. And what he says is that eugenics means not to be confined in a particular class and then marry only among them. So it's not that. Just break all the walls of caste and class and religion, and even perhaps you can even think of breaking the barriers of the nation. Perhaps eugenic means if I get married to a European, the result can be wonderful, perhaps, because if that person is also intellectually high, if I am also intellectually high, then it is a good combination. Likewise, it cannot, of course, eugenic cannot be confined to particular class based on religion. So he says, what sort of race of men should it have produced? If caste is eugenic, it should have produced a wonderful progeny. But physically speaking, the Hindus are a C3 people. They are, what C3 people means, very, very low. They are a race of pygmies and dwarfs, stunted in stature and wanting in stamina. It is a nation 9/10 of which is declared to be unfit for military service. This shows that the caste system does not embody the eugenics of modern scientists. What he is trying to say is that caste does not have any scientific background, as the promoters of caste system actually claims, as if they at all claim that this is the reason why caste system is important, or that caste system has a scientific reason. He's actually shattering all those concepts. It is a social system which embodies arrogance and selfishness of a perverse section of the Hindus who were superior enough in social status to set it in fashion and who had the authority to force it on their inferiors. So this is perhaps these are the reasons why annihilation of caste was rejected by the persons who invited him to talk on. And we will also look at Dr. Ambedkar. He was the chairman of drafting committee. How, in what way he was associated with the making of the constitution? He was a member of committee for the functions of the Constituent Assembly, member of National Flag and HOC Committee, member Fundamental Rights Subcommittee, member Minority Subcommittee, member Advisory Committee, member Union Constitution Committee, member Subcommittee on Amendment, member Ad Hoc Committee on the Supreme Court, member Ad Hoc Committee on Citizenship, member Subcommittee on Minority Problems Affecting East Punjab and West Bengal. So he was into 22. I have not mentioned all those. He had been associated with 22 committees while he was a chairman of the drafting committee itself. That means nothing happened or no committee functioned without him. That is what we have to finally understand. And it was a wonderful way of, you know, a person involving everything. And to him, nobody was able to answer him when he was saying something back. It was like, you know, once a challenge is posed, it was very impossible to defeat him. That we find, if you want to see that, just take the Constituent Assembly debates and read something, just at least something what just Ambedkar said. And that for your understanding, because whenever I may be referring to articles, maybe I in the draft constitution, when I say article 14, it will be actually article 20, but I have tried to make it in tune with the present article. But then in somewhere you may find the quotations in the constituent assembly debates are about the draft constitution and the respective articles. So you shouldn't confuse. When if I say article 15 in the draft constitution, it means the 21 of today. So if I will try to make it clear then and there, but if at all I miss something, you can keep this in mind. Draft 7 was in the present 12, draft 8 present 13, then 14 there was no respective ones, it was new. Then 9 was 15, I mean today's 15 was 9, that means there was a gap of 5 here in the first 2, and then from there onwards 6. Just you can just minus 6 and you will reach the draft one from there on. And after that somewhere here it has risen to 7. That means after 23 it is the difference of 6 articles. After that 30 it is because of the introduction of 23A, it is when it comes to 24 there is a gap of 7, and in 25 also there is a gap of 7. So this is for your understanding. And if you want to refer to the Constituent Assembly debates, or if you want to search for something connected with a particular article, if you make a search, like if you search Constituent Assembly debate on Article 21, you will not get the present 21, but you will only get the 21 in the draft article. So you must either search, if you want to do something on Article 21, you must search on Article 15, Constituent Assembly debate on Article 15, or you can search Constituent Assembly debate on life and personal liberty. Otherwise, and when I searched, this is what happened. That is why I wanted just to tell you. And now, just some comments about Dr. Ambedkar and his contribution in the Constituent Assembly debates before we go into the fundamental rights aspect of that. It was by Algurai Shastri. He said, "I do not understand why we should not take into consideration the Hindi version of the draft when it is before us. We may take up for consideration the Hindi version." Hindi version, when they were talking about Hindi version, he said, "Dr. Ambedkar, who himself is a great scholar of the Sanskrit language." I took this just to show you that he was also a scholar of Sanskrit language. The rest, of course, is of not much importance, but then that he was versatile. That is what I wanted to show you. He was a versatile personality because if you read just one paper that I was referring to, that is on caste, you will be taken aback. Look at the language he has used. Wonderful English languages, the vocabulary he has, and the way the convincing and the articulation he has made. So that this is just to show that part of that. Then Mr. Frank Anthony, what he said is, "Although Dr. Ambedkar is not present in the house, I feel that as a lawyer at least, I ought to congratulate him for the symmetrical and lucid analysis which he gave us of the principles underlying our draft constitution. Whatever different views we may hold about this draft constitution, I feel that this will be considered that it is a monumental document, at least from the physical point of view, if from no other point of view. And I think it would be churlish for us not to offer a word of special thanks to the members of the drafting committee, because I am certain that they must have put in an infinite amount of labor and skill to be able to prepare such a vast document." So from the talk of many others, we understand the personality of Ambedkar. Then this is the speech of Ambedkar in the first days when he was talking about, he was reacting to the criticism leveled. Then I will read it because I didn't want to edit it at all, and I didn't want to put it in my own language because it will be my language. Let us hear it from his own language. I would have actually played a video, but then that will be like, we won't be able to take only that we want. Otherwise, it was better to hear him. If possible, you can hear him, because I think all these things are there in the video. So now, turning to the main question, a student of, these are his words, okay, in his speech. "A student of constitutional law, If a copy of Constitution is placed in his hands, it's sure to ask two questions. And as constitutional law students, I will also say that I am also a constitutional law student, not a teacher, as Vidit sir was pointing out. I won't dare to say that I could master even an article in the Constitution. It's not a humility, but it's a fact. Because the more you read, you understand that it is very deep, and that it is almost impossible for a person to master even a part of the Constitution. But if we read Ambedkar's speech, we are going to get an insight into what he meant while drafting this Constitution. Because, you know, there are certain words which people think are taken from the American concept, but he actually explains here that it is just a word but not the concept. Firstly, what is the form of government that is envisaged in the Constitution? Secondly, what is the form of the Constitution? Four of these are the two crucial matters which every Constitution has to deal with. I will begin with the first of the two questions. In the draft Constitution, there is placed the head of the Indian Union, a functionary who is called the President of the Union. The title of this functionary reminds one of the President of the United States, but beyond identity of names, there is nothing in common between the forms of government prevalent in America and the form of government proposed under the draft Constitution. The American form of government is called the presidential system of government. What the draft Constitution proposes is a parliamentary system. The two are fundamentally different. So this is a clarification he has made on about the president. So we shouldn't think that this is a presidential form, because there is a head who is called the president. So we know that president of US is totally different from our president. So that was made clear way back in 1940s in his speech. Now, there was another criticism. Our Constitution is just a copy of many other constitutions, as I was saying. So look at the language he has used. The charge of producing a blind copy of the constitutions of other countries is based, I am sure, on an inadequate study of the Constitution. I have shown what is new in the draft Constitution, and I am sure that those who have studied other constitutions and who are prepared to consider the matter dispassionately will agree that the drafting committee, in performing its duty, has not been guilty of such blind and slavish limitation as it is represented to be. Look at his language. He, you know, whenever it was necessary, he has used very harsh words also, that we are coming to next. And I think that was needed, because that was a kind of criticism level, and he thought that those criticisms were made without reading the materials which he had read. So he knows that what they say is without reading the materials, reading which he had drafted the Constitution. So perhaps that might have annoyed him. That is why the answers which he gave in very harsh words are in the next slide. I chose to take this because I had an opportunity to work on constitutional morality more than once. One, I was presenting a paper in actually my classmates' college, in the School of Legal Thought. And I was commenting on the 377 case, that is the 377, section 377 of IPC, which was made unconstitutional based on the constitutional morality. There I had read something about constitutional morality, and I was also guiding a student who was writing on constitutional morality, guiding a student on writing his dissertation for LLM. But actually what I gathered from those judgments are not much in line with what Dr. Ambedkar had in his mind while he was talking about constitutional morality, not only in the Constitutional Assembly debate, but if we look at his writings and his speeches, there is a website itself on his writings and his speeches in the website of the Ministry of External Affairs. There also he is elaborating on the concept of constitutional morality. And what he said is that he is quoting Grote, and he says a paramount reverence for the forms of the constitution, enforcing obedience to authority, acting under and within these forms, yet combined with the habit of open speech, of action subject only to definite legal control and unrestrained censure of those very authorities as to all their public acts, combined too with a perfect confidence in the bosom of every citizen amidst the bitterness of party contests, that the forms of the constitution will not be less sacred in the eyes of his opponents than in his own. And there was a hear. People were actually applauding what he said. There was a heavy applause on that. That this is his concept on constitutional morality. That is, what I understand from is that it is going beyond the words of the constitution, but take the spirit of the constitution, and to be obedient to the constitution. But of course, you have also the freedoms of open speech, etc. And if at all you are controlled, it is a control governed by the constitution, which is required. To put it in as an example, you can speak, okay, you can speak whatever you want to speak. But when you speak defaming another person, the state will come and control you. So this is a kind of, I have a freedom, but at the same time, I don't have a freedom beyond the limits, or I don't have a freedom to curtail somebody else's freedom. So that is what I understand from the word constitutional morality, as was explained by Dr. Ambedkar. And I think he is a fan of this word. He has used it in very many places. Actually, perhaps the entire constitution can be understood from this concept, because it's all about reverence for the forms of the constitution. And at the same time, you are restricted in certain areas, but you are free on the other areas. That means it's a very good balancing of freedom and self-discipline, rather. Or if you are not ready to be self-disciplined, there will be law to control you. So this is, not too much of restriction from the part of the state, neither too much of freedom on the part of the individual. Very, very beautiful concept. But that has been given a bit different perception, I think, when it came to the judgments. Perhaps they didn't fall back on the Constitutional Assembly debates to get that. Now, his reaction to the criticisms of fundamental rights. I will read him, because I don't want to put my words into his mouth. Let us hear from his own words. The most criticized part of the draft constitution is that which relates to fundamental rights. That means it's very clear that it was the most controversial part in the constitution. It is said that, actually, you must remember that these are all Ambedkar's reaction in the Constitutional Assembly debate. It is said that Article 13, and I have written it, it is a present Article 19, which defines fundamental rights, is riddled with so many exceptions, that the exceptions have eaten up the rights altogether. This is, if you look at 19.1a, it's talks about freedom of speech and expression. But we find that there are, in 19.2, there are restrictions. The constitutional law students are all aware of that restriction. The restrictions are sovereignty and integrity of India, friendly relation with other nations, incitement to an offense, contempt of court, defamation, public order, morality. So if it says nothing will prevent the state from law making reasonable restrictions on the grounds of these things. Okay, that means when the court, when the state feels they want to make a legislation for reasonably restricting the people from exercising their fundamental right, that is, if it is a fundamental right to freedom of speech and expression, then 19.2, if it is freedom of speech and the next one, assembly, then 19.3, association, 19.4, like that. So the criticism was that, it was very interesting to hear the criticism. They said that, okay, you have given fundamental right with one hand and taken it back with the other hand. Because what is left, these were the criticism. What is left, if you look at the wordings of the members, you will find that they were, actually they were furious. And they were almost on the verge of slapping the constitutional makers. They said, we don't understand what you mean. On the one hand, you are giving a right and you have put a lot of restrictions on that. So this is his reaction to that. He said, it is said that Article 13, which defines fundamental rights with so many exceptions, that exceptions have eaten up the rights altogether. It is condemned as a kind of deception. In the opinion of the critics, fundamental rights are not fundamental rights unless they are absolute rights. The critics rely on the Constitution of the United States and the Bill of Rights embodied in the first 10 amendments to that Constitution in support of their contention. It is said that the fundamental rights in the American Bill of Rights are real because they are not subject to limitations or exceptions. So look at the challenge that was posed to a particular article. Look at his answer. He says, I am sorry to say that the whole of the criticism of fundamental rights is based on a misconception. In the first place, the criticism, insofar as it seeks to distinguish fundamental rights from non-fundamental rights, is not sound. It is incorrect to say that fundamental rights are absolute, while non-fundamental rights are not absolute. The real distinction between the two is that non-fundamental rights are created by agreement between parties, while fundamental rights are the gift of the law. Because fundamental rights are the gift of the state, it does not follow that the state cannot qualify them. So what he was up to was, as all constitutional law students know, when you have a right, there definitely will have to be some restrictions on that. And the fear of the members were that, especially on freedom of speech and expression, some raised the objection that we were under suppression so far. And we were not able to raise our voice against the government because it was a British government, it was a foreign government. Now, are you trying to continue the same? That is, you have given the state a lot of powers under 19.2. And then whenever we want to raise a voice against the state, they can come with some restrictions and you are giving it space for that. So this for that, he's giving an answer that inherent with the fundamental rights are the state's power to control them also. So even what he said is that even if we had not put the restrictions in 19.2, it was the power inherent, because no power, no fundamental right can be absolute. So how he justified it was that he said, because we have given certain grounds, the power is restricted at least that much. Otherwise, they would have taken anything. They could have restricted you in any matter, saying that it is a police power. So that way, it was a very beautiful reaction from him. Now, we will find that almost all the fundamental rights have their own restrictions. 21, it is a procedure established by law. 19, it is all spelled out in those articles. And then we find that 14, there can be restrictions, especially 15, 16, 17, etc. We find that even though equality is there, there can be protective discrimination. That means the state can make laws for the protection of a special class. Especially, there is a very special provision for backward class on the one hand, for women and children on the other hand, we find in 15.3. So these are all possible. That is what Ambedkar argued, that even if we don't give these special powers to them, they have this power. But then his hope is that the state is not the foreign state. It is our own state. That will respect your rights. That is what he says. Now, this is the reaction of the criticism on directive principles on state policy. We all know that directive principles on state policy is a non-justiciable. The rights are non-justiciable. That means they cannot be enforced. So there were criticism that if they cannot be enforceable, why do you want to include it? So his answer is that if it is said that the directive principle have no legal force behind them, I am prepared to admit it. But I am not prepared to admit that they have no sort of binding force at all. Nor am I prepared to concede that they are useless because they have no binding force in law. And he says as a reaction, such a thing is to my mind to be welcomed whenever there is a grant of power in general terms for peace, order and good government. It is necessary that it should be accompanied by instructions regulating its exercise. So what we find is that it's a directive principle to the state. In a way, they are directing the states to which direction their power should be used. In what all matters, they should have schemes. So if Part 4 was not there, perhaps the state need not have bothered about the senior citizens. They need not have bothered about the widows. They need not bother about the disabled, because these are all directions given, and they need not have bothered about lessening the concentration of wealth and the labor's right, the exploitation of children. All these are in the, and the most valuable rights we find: food, shelter, clothing, standard of living, right to health, right to education, uniform civil code. These are all in part 4. So these are all, you know, just guiding principles. And it is also said that it was for only for 10 years actually they are non-justiciable. After that they are only going to be justiciable, but it is gone on amended to be in effect for the at another 10 years. But unfortunately, we find that almost all the rights in part 4 are transformed into legislations. For example, equal remuneration is there in the part 4 as a directive, but we have the Equal Remuneration Act. Right to education up to 15 years is there in Article 45, and we have the legislation now. Of course, the legislation is based on 21A, because first it was transformed into 21A as a fundamental right, and then we have the Free and Compulsory Education Act. Right to Free and Compulsory Education Act was there. Likewise, if you look at almost all the aspects in part 4, we find some kind of the other legislations in this respect. So we can say that all those are transformed into legal rights, and they are no more unenforceable. They are all enforceable, because they have all become rights. Or if something is left, the judiciary has read them into part 3. And after reading it into part 3, the legislature was constrained to make laws, because judiciary was doing it, which the parliament should have done. So that is a shame on them, in fact. For a long time, you are not doing it, so we are doing it. That is a message that is sent by the judiciary. So there, if you are interested, just look at every article in part 4 and find out whether they are transformed into legislations. They have almost all of them have. Now, then there was a criticism about a very strong center. The proponents wanted to have a weak center with very strong states. So what his answer was: some critics have said that the center is too strong. Others have said that it must be made stronger. The draft constitution has struck a balance. However much you may deny powers to the center, it is difficult to prevent the center from becoming strong. Conditions in modern world are much that centralization of powers is inevitable. One has only to consider the growth of federal government, etc. You can read that. Finally, what he says is that in countries where, for example, he's talking about the federal government in USA, which was actually having a very strong state with weak center, see, it has outgrown its former self and has overshadowed and eclipsed state governments. This is due to modern conditions. The same conditions are sure to operate on the government of India, and nothing that one can do will help to prevent it from being strong. On the other hand, we must resist the tendency to make it stronger. It cannot chew more than it can digest. Its strength must be commensurate with its weight. It would be a folly to make it so strong that it may fall by its own weight. Look at the way he has answered, because there was an argument for making it stronger. So his answer is that it would be folly to make it so strong that it may fall by its own weight. And to the criticism or challenge that it must be made weaker, his answer is that every country has to be or should have a very strong center, because otherwise its new unity will be in trouble. Now, response to other criticisms. I believe I have dealt with all the adverse criticisms that have been leveled against the draft constitution as settled by the drafting committee. I don't think that I have left out any important comment on criticism that has been made during the last 8 months during which the constitution has been before the public. It is for the constituent assembly to decide whether they will accept the constitution as settled by the draft committee or whether they shall alter it before passing it. That means after drafting committee drafted it was put before the constituent assembly, and after the debates in the assembly only the constitution was adopted. And you will find that there were not much differences from what was is actually submitted by the drafting committee and what we find today. Especially, I will say, just because of the presence of Dr. Ambedkar, he was defending every article like anything. And to some, no, I have taken some articles on which Ambedkar had very strong comments. So there are many other articles on which he didn't say anything. He only said, I don't accept these comments, or rather, I don't accept these amendments. And then the amendments were not accepted. So it was, look at the dominance he had and the vocabulary he had, the convincing power he had, the articulative power he had, the gift of gab he had. So all these have shut the mouths of the opponents, and they were all happy. In fact, it's not that they were discontented. The way in which he was answering was very welcome. The constitution as settled by the drafting committee is good enough to make in this country a start with. I feel that it is workable, it is flexible, and it is strong enough to hold the country together both in peacetime and in wartime. Indeed, if I may say so, if things go wrong under the new constitution, the reason will not be that we had a bad constitution. What we will have to say is that man was failed. So then, that was his. Look at the wonderful foresight he had. He said it is flexible, and that was the very reason why he was very confident that this will work. Because if it was not flexible, it would have perhaps broken. Now look, you can look at how flexible the constitution is. The amendment that can be made, it is a very flexible provision. So we can make contextual changes to the constitution whenever required. So we have, you know, a lot of amendments because we don't have a very rigid amendment procedure. And flexible also because the judiciary has enough space to add something without striking it down. For example, when there was an argument as to whether right to privacy is a part of Article 21, when there was an argument whether right to livelihood is a part of 21, whether right to health is part of 21, whether freedom of press is part of 191A. So when these questions are asked, if the courts were not able to find a space where they could add their creative interpretation, they should have said that this right is not here. Then if it was that much, it was there needed, then we would have been constrained to go for amendments. And we should have gone on adding fundamental rights one after the other in the constitution. And it would have been like, sometimes might have been 21, if we have only 21A, it would have been 21A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, it would have gone to Z, because that much rights are added. But the judiciary has done it without amendment, without touching anything. They have read whatever they wanted to read, perhaps with the help of the international human rights law mainly. Because right to privacy, if the question is to be decided, it was solely based on the provision in the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. They said that this is a right which is there in the International Covenant. India is a party to the covenant. India has no excuse for not giving this right to its citizens. So they were reading those things into the constitution. So whatever is there in International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, or even in UDHR, or even in International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, or in the Convention on Rights of the Child, or in the Convention on Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women, these were all judiciary thought part of the responsibility of the Union of India to give to the citizens of India. And they said that, look, there is no justification on your part not to make it part of the Indian system. If you are not doing that, we are doing it. So they have found a haven in Article 21, and because it is flexible. So look at the way Ambedkar was looking at the progress of the constitution. He said it is flexible and it's strong enough to hold the country together, both in peacetime and in wartime. Indeed, nothing will go wrong. That is the actually ultimately that is what he sees. The constitution can't be blamed. It's only men can be blamed if at all something goes wrong. Now, this is Article 15. This is the present article, and I'm writing this just because the forthcoming discussions with this, sir, how many more time I have got? 15 minutes more, or?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, 15 minutes.
Yes, 15 minutes.
Okay. I will hurry through the forthcoming slides. Now, I brought 15 because the words which are put in red were all explained by Dr. Ambedkar. In fact, while discussing Article 15, nobody might have ever thought of such kind of an interpretation. The Article 15 says the state shall not discriminate against any citizen on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them. No citizen shall, on grounds only of religion, race, caste, sex, place of birth, or any of them, be subject to any disability, liability, restriction, or condition with regard to access to shops, public restaurants, hotels, and places of public entertainment, or the use of wells, tanks, bathing ghats, roads, and places of public resort maintained wholly or partly out of state funds or dedicated to the use of the general public. Nothing in this article shall prevent the state from making any special provision for women and children. Now, the word state funds. The next slide is on the word state funds. Somebody was criticizing on the use of the word state funds. Now, he has given an answer for that. That is the answer. That is the reason why the drafting committee felt that the words, the revenues of the state, should be replaced by the word state funds. Actually, someone was advocating for using the word revenues of the state. He said the word state fund was used because it's a very simple thing. In the administrative parlance, which has been in vogue in India for considerably long time, we are accustomed to speak of revenues of provincial government or revenues of the central government. When we come to speak of local boards or district boards, we generally use the phrase local funds and not revenues. That is the terminology which has been in operation throughout India in all the provinces. Now, the honorable members of the House will remember that we are using the word state in this part to include not only the central government and the provincial governments and Indian states, but also local authorities, such as district local boards or taluka local boards, on the port trust authorities. So far as they are concerned, the proper word is fund. It is therefore desirable in the view of the fact that we are making these fundamental rights obligatory, not merely upon the central government and the provincial governments, but also upon the district local bodies and taluka local boards. To use a wider phraseology would be applicable not only to the central government, but also to the local bodies which are included in the definition of the word state. I hope that my honorable friend, Mr. Kamath, will now understand that amendment which I have moved is not merely verbal but has some substance in it. So it is primarily what it says is that under Article 12, even the local bodies will come, and then you can't use the word just central government. You shouldn't mistake when you say state funds, it is just the local fund, because it was used like that. So it was an explanation given to the enforcement of fundamental right. Now let us see, there was another argument. My friend Mr. Tahir, who moved this amendment, referred particularly, this was a suggestion, or rather an amendment sought to make any violation of discrimination, rather any discriminatory practice, should be made an offense. That was a suggestion, and this is his answer. He said, who moved this, referred particularly to the position of the untouchables, and he said that in regard to these acts which prevent the untouchables from sharing equally the privileges enjoyed by the general public, we will not be successful in achieving our purpose unless these acts preventing them from using places of public resort were made offenses. But he will see that the purpose is carried out entirely by the provisions contained in Article 11. Article 11 is the present Article 17, which specifically deals with untouchability. Instead of leaving it to Parliament or to the state to make it a crime, the article itself declares that any such interference with their rights shall be treated as an offense punishable below. This is a wonderful way of looking at the different articles of the Constitution. What a member suggested was that, that was Mr. Tahir suggested, was that in the Constitution, which talks about Article 15 itself, that is, I was showing you Article 15, here it says the state shall not discriminate against any person, and then they should not be discriminated as far as the access to shop, etc. No, the suggestion was that if someone discriminates, especially the untouchables, or someone denies them the access to these kinds of things, it should be made an offense. That was the suggestion. Then what Ambedkar said was that Article 17, which talks about abolition of untouchability, that gives the state the power to make laws. And we find that we have two legislations. One is SCST Prevention of Atrocities Act, and the other is Civil Rights Act, Protection of Civil Rights Act. These two legislations are made in pursuance of Article 17, which are, one is on ensuring these rights to the untouchables, rather to the person belonging to the SCST community, and also the SCST Prevention of Atrocities Act. These are all, if you see the preamble of the act itself, you find that it is made as a part of Article 17. I will read you Article 17 if you want. I think you are all aware of Article 17. It's abolition of, I will read it. It says, I think you are aware, but still, for the, as Ambedkar was answering it like this, untouchability is abolished and its practice in any form is forbidden. The enforcement of any disability arising out of untouchability shall be an offense punishable in accordance with law. This is what is given in Article 17, and that is what Ambedkar is referring to here as Article 11, which specifically deals with untouchability. And see, it is perhaps the only article in the Constitution which directs the state to make something an offense. Otherwise, they don't bother. You can make it either an offense or you can make it a civil wrong. It is left to the particular legislature. But this is perhaps, I will say perhaps, maybe in no fundamental right you find it. And then I can say perhaps with precision, that is the only article in the Constitution which directs a state to make something an offense. That is the disability that is arising from untouchability shall be made an offense. And this is what Dr. Ambedkar says. See what does he say? He says, instead of leaving it to the parliament or the state to make it a crime, the article itself declares that such interference with their rights shall be treated as an offense punishable by law. That means if 17 was not there, still the state would have made a law, but that was up to them. They could have made it, they could not have made it, or they could have made it just a civil wrong. For example, Domestic Violence Act, in the first instance, it is not a crime. Of course, if the orders are violated, the person will be in prison. It is basically a civil legislation. That was a choice of the legislature, even though they have made 498A, cruelty or dowry death, etc., made offense. Domestic Violence Act is basically a civil legislation. But here, as Ambedkar himself was saying, that this is already made an offense, rather it is a direction. Though you don't find the word it is an offense in the Constitution, but there is a very specific direction to the state to make it an offense. And this is about other members, about the task of Dr. Ambedkar. I join in the pleasant task to compliment Dr. Ambedkar for the well worked out scheme he has played before the House, the hard work he was put in, and this, his yesterday's able and lucid speech. Now, Article 14, there was a suggestion to make SCST also along with the women and children in the special provision. So what he said was that, with regard, look at the way he is looking at the protection of SCST. With regard to amendment number 323, moved by Professor K.T. Shah, the object of which is to add SC and ST along with the women and children, I am afraid it may have just the opposite effect. The object which all of us have in mind is that the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes should not be segregated from the general public. If this is the object, that is, they shall not be completely outside the society, and the society should not start labeling them, but it is assimilation. So see, look at the very clear words in which he said this is the object. And then he said that, so we don't need to have a particular class of SCST, though of course later on we added these special provision for SCST also. That was not there in the original constitution. So Ambedkar didn't want any special treatment for these castes. What they wanted was not to be, they should not be segregated from the general public. Of course, he was for punishing the offenders who were harsh to them, but then they should be assimilated to the system. That is what he wanted. Now about shop. And that is what I was showing you here. I had made some words access to shops. So the word shop, he's talking about the interpretation of the word shop. What shop? There was a member who asked him, does it include the office? Oh, no. Before that, there is one. Then I come to my friend Nagappa. He has asked me to explain some of the words which have been used. In particular, what he asked was whether the shop includes laundry and shaving place. A barber shop. So what he said, look at the way he has conceived the word shop. He said, to define the word shop in the most generic term, one can think of is to state that shop is a place. This is his definition. Shop is a place where the owner is prepared to offer his service to anybody who is prepared to go there seeking his service. A laundryman, therefore, would be a man sitting in his shop, offering to serve the public in a particular respect, namely wash the dirty clothes of a customer. Similarly, the owner of a shaving saloon would be sitting there offering a service for any person who enters the saloon. So that means need not necessarily be a vegetable shop or a grocery shop. It's not that. It can be any place where service is offered. Look at another question. Does it include the offices of a doctor and a lawyer? And his answer was, certainly it will include anybody who offers a service. I am using it in a generic sense. I should like to point out, therefore, that the word shop used here is not used in the limited sense of permitting entry. It is used in the larger sense of requiring the services if the terms of service are agreed to. Of course, it is qualified by the word funded by the state. That means if the doctor and lawyer, they're purely private persons, perhaps it will have its own restrictions as far as the article is concerned, Article 15 is concerned. But he said the shop even includes the services of the doctors and the lawyers. Then there was another question as to, I'll finish in 5 minutes. So I'll just rush through. This was again about whether it includes burial ground, tank, whether it includes ponds, rivers, streams. The answer was that public resort includes burial ground also, and the way in which he said was that I don't know whether anybody is interested in a burial ground. That was his response. But he said that if it is maintained wholly or partly out of public funds, then even to the burial ground nobody can deny access to anybody else. And ponds, of course, comes within the term tank, but he said rivers and streams do not come within the tank. But then the answer was that even though it doesn't come, see the last one. Therefore, my answer to my friend is that he need have no fears with regard to the use of rivers, streams, canals, etc., because it is perfectly possible for the parliament to make any law under Article 11, means Article 17, today's Article 17, to remove any such disability found. That means the state can make it an offense if these people are not allowed access to rivers, etc. That means they are not covered under Article 15. But they are covered under Article 17 and the law made pursuant to Article 17. Now again, from annihilation of caste, Sagar quote, which I thought, I can and ask the political minded Hindus, are you fit for political power? Even though you do not have a large class of your own countrymen like the untouchables to use public schools, are you fit for political power even though you do not allow them to use of public wells? Are you fit for political power even though you do not allow them to use public streets? Are you fit for political power even though you do not allow them to wear what apparel or ornaments they like? Are you fit for political power even though you do not allow them to eat any food they like? I can ask a string of such questions, but these will suffer. These are all asked because of some examples he gave previous to this in his annihilation of caste. That is, perhaps I will take only the last one. This is because, you know, there was a function where the untouchable, he has used the word untouchable, I don't know whether he was happy to use that word, but anyway, a person who was considered as untouchable by others. That is what I would like to say. So a person wanted to treat his friends on his victory, and in that function ghee was served. Ghee was served, and persons belonging to the upper class came and they dismantled everything, they spoiled everything, saying the reason was that ghee is not meant for you people, it is only for the high class. So it is based on that that he has asked this question. And the other question, where what apparel or ornaments they like, he has given another example where the Baliyas of, I think that is a word, that is a the name for low caste in Madhya Pradesh. They were given certain directions by the upper class, for like Patels and all. They said you can't wear gold covered, like gold laced ornament, I mean dresses. You can't wear kurtas with fancy colors. And then they have given some instructions. If you can't do all these things, you should immediately leave this place. That was their instruction. And many had to leave the place after fights. They couldn't fight and they couldn't withstand the fight. So it is based on all these, he has asked this, this question. And it is good if you can read Annihilation of Caste. He has given a lot of examples where it was very pathetic for the people belonging to the untouchable caste to live. Now, the there was another suggestion that the word backward has produced a paradise. This is where I think he has used very harsh words. He said, these are the technicalities, like these were the number of amendments. Okay, we will come to the next slide where it is very clear. I do not think that I am called upon to say anything with regard to amendments number 334, 336 and 337. Such observation, therefore, as I shall make in the course of my speech will be confined to the question of residence, about which there has been so much. So I will skip all that and we'll look at this one. This is a very, I thought, a very beautiful language. Yes, this is it. They said, instead of producing a constitution, you have produced a paradise for lawyers. This is what the criticism was. And he said, I am not prepared to say that this constitution will not give rise to questions which will involve legal interpretation or judicial interpretation. In fact, I would like to ask Mr. Krishnamachari if he can point out to me any instance of any constitution in the world which has not been a paradise for lawyers. I would particularly ask him to refer to the vast storehouse of law reports with regard to the Constitution of the United States, Canada, and other countries. I am therefore not ashamed at all if this Constitution hereinafter, for purposes of interpretation, is required to be taken to the federal court. That is the fate of every Constitution and every drafting committee. I shall therefore not labor that point at all. Look at his wisdom and his foresight. And he's happy to see that there will be interpretations. And of course, if there are possible interpretations, one may argue in one way, the other may argue the other way. Let the constitution grow like that. That was his vision. Now, 13, okay, that I am skipping. Then freedoms, I think I was telling you what it was. That is, there was a criticism on too much of freedom, and then that I will just explain without reading it. What he said was that in the place of existing law, there should have been a word which is not repugnant to the spirit of the provisions of Article 8. That was like, and what they said was that the law shall not violate a fundamental right. That was the point that was raised, and they said that the law which is not repugnant to the spirit of constitution should be added. So what he said was that if an existing law violates a fundamental right, that is not no more a law. So there is no need of such an explanation. That is what it is all about. Then reasonable classification, I think I can skip that. If you ask me, I'll answer that later. So he said there was a, instead of the word a scheduled caste, it was aboriginal in the beginning, but then later on it was changed to scheduled caste because the fundamental rights, the committee, there was a committee on tribal areas. They submitted their report and they used the word scheduled tribes. So we are using that word instead of aboriginals. Then this is on freedom of press. Yes, I will say only the sum and substance of it. Ambedkar thought that this is not a right of the press, but it is a right of the individual editors. So there is no need of a freedom of press at all. But of course, we know that later on the courts added this right as part of freedom of speech and expression. Again, saving personal laws as part of the right to religion. He said, I think if you ask me questions, I can show this. Actually, this is a very wonderful reaction from him when it was, the question was, as a part of right to religion, personal laws should be preserved. So he said, we are having this liberty in order to reform our social system, which is so full of iniquities, so full of inequalities, discriminations and other things which conflict with our fundamental rights. So what he felt is that if you allow personal laws, there will be a lot of religious practices which are going to take away your fundamental rights. So you, it is not good that you preserve your personal laws. That was his saying, that was his reaction. But we find that there was a lot of personal laws and they were challenged, and the court had difficulties in answering these questions because they feared that that may raise perhaps even racial problems, communal problems. In some cases the courts have shown the courage, but in some cases the courts have not. And then 21, I was telling you, the problem was whether to use the word procedure established by or due process. Ambedkar said that both have their own positives and negatives. Let us go ahead with this and let us see how it works. That was his reaction. And then very interesting thing, there was an amendment of sort on Article 23, which talks about forced labor. And it was of interest to me because I was asking my students just some days back, that is, we have abolished forced labor, but we still have the rigorous imprisonment. And as a part of rigorous imprisonment, a person is forced to work. And we have not exempted it in Article 23. We have not exempted it. That means, is it legal? No. That was the question. Actually, there was already a suggestion. That is, neither this, it was to be like this, neither slavery nor involuntary servitude with as such as beggar, except as a punishment for crime, shall exist within the Union state. But that was not actually taken into account. But the question came before the court later on as to whether this is a forced labor. It was in 1994. It's a case of State of Gujarat versus High Court of Gujarat, and the High Court was answering this question. This did not form part of the present constitution, but I thought the amendment was, still it was, it became a problem later on. Now this is my conclusion, realization of fundamental rights. Actually, what I feel is that fundamental rights are given, but then if you want to get it enforced, it's very expensive. Going to the Supreme Court, getting your fundamental rights enforced is very expensive. Then fundamental rights are usually said to be violated by the state, and it is only against the state. And then state can violate your fundamental right through illegal arrest, detention, etc. But the problem is that we have problems from the fellow beings as well. They may discriminate you, they may behave very badly to you, they may kill you. These are all matters of your life, but in strict sense, they can't be called fundamental rights, but which results in the denial of these crimes. Especially, for example, there may be some customs in some society which is unwritten. Of course, there's no law, but you might feel that discrimination is shown to women. At least, you know, in a very subtle level, even nobody can even see it, that there are a lot of subtle discriminations shown against women. If it is a law, you can challenge. But if it is just a practice which is very, you know, silent and silent violence, those things are done by the society and no remedy is there actually against that. So that is a violation by private persons. And then regarding the first one, if it is the violation by the state, you can approach the court. But if it's violated by the public, if you think that it has become so intolerant, there can be protest. It can even go to the form of a revolution. But you know, these are not very easy to happen. Even revolutions are not very easy to happen. The approaching the court, people will approach the court only if they have money, only if they have money, accepting the public interest litigations. But you know, if people are not very happy to approach the court otherwise, unless you feel that it is very much needed. So what is the way out? Dr. Ambedkar was aware of the discrimination that prevailed in India to the people belong to low caste, women and laborers. And he has said it in many, many places that these people are subjected to heavy discrimination. And as Vidyut sir was saying, he was instrumental in doing many things for these classes. He has found religion itself as a cause of this. Right to equality is difficult to achieve in such a society unless there is a strong constitutional support along with change in the mindset of people. That is what I feel. A constitution alone will not help us. It is a question of change in the mindset. And I remember one thing which is said by Sri Narayana Guru. And he has said in one of his verses that if you look at a cow, you can understand it is a cow. If you look at a human being, you can understand it's a human being. But just by looking at a human being, you can't understand. Of course, forgetting all the dress or something which may distinguish him as a religion. Okay, that is his intentional doing. Otherwise, without such marks of religion, a person, two, three persons are standing. You can't distinguish between a Hindu, Christian, Muslim and that. So it's so simple that there is no such thing as caste that exists. But then why people are not aware or they are not understanding this simple truth? That is what he has said in a Sanskrit shloka. So I was remembering that it is there is a need for change in the mindset of the people. And we will also find something very interesting. Fundamental rights are getting more and more dimensions contextually, which was envisaged by Dr. Ambedkar and his team. Indian judiciary being the forefront of the matter. But to expect the judiciary to every time, so we have to take the matter, taking the matter always to the judiciary is not. And I feel fundamental rights and human rights are in the hands of the state. And it is better that you think of your duty. And it should be, I think every one of us should start. If you think that others' rights are important, then they will think that your rights are important. But if you focus on your right, others will focus on their right. It's always better that you look at others' rights and you take it as your duty. That will make a lot of change. And I think the change, we can start from ourselves. If you think, I will respect the dignity of all fellow beings, and then you will find the difference. That it has to come from within. And if you look at the UDHR, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, it starts from the word, all are born equal. And then they live in the spirit of brotherhood. That is why I feel that it's not only just all Indians are my brothers and sisters, all human beings are my brothers and sisters, wherever they may be in US, they may be in Uganda, wherever they are. So this was his hope and desire. Again, quoting him, I'm quite convinced that given time, this is the wordings of Ambedkar, I'm quite convinced that given time and circumstances, nothing in the world will prevent this country from becoming one. Then there was a heavy applause. With all our castes and creeds, I have not the slightest hesitation that we will in some form be a united people. I have no hesitation in saying that notwithstanding the agitation of the Muslim League for the partition of India, someday enough light would dawn upon the Muslims themselves and they too will begin to think that a united India is better even for them. Actually, it was a speech before the partition took place, but then he was hoping that everyone, in spite of all these, we will all be together and let us make it come true.
Teacher, finished?
Yes, thank you. So thank you so much, teacher.
I think we had a very wonderful session and we could see scholarship flowing from her in all directions and we were definitely enlightened. I'm quite sure that all of us definitely would be enlightened with such thoughts that she could give us. And let me take just 3 minutes time and just conclude those points she made. Actually, she could give us a very, very vivid picture of the attributes of Ambedkar and his contribution in the formation of a constitution generally, and in particular in the formation of the part 3 fundamental rights. And she was pointing out certain attributes or characteristics of Ambedkar. One is persuasive ability of Ambedkar. Second is his versatility, and third, his linguistic skills, all coming from his knowledge. And she was pointing out the fact that he was a member of multiple groups, and it has shown his ability of multitasking. He was also talking about his ability to synthesize essentially required elements from multiple constitutions, and this shows his ingenuity, creativity as well. And she has also pointed out those areas where Ambedkar emphasized the sacredness of the constitution, where the sacredness of the constitution resides, particularly in relation to the values of liberty, equality, and justice. She has also could convincingly establish Ambedkar's ability to reason with the strength of logic and his ability to be flexible enough wherever it is required. And throughout the constitutional making scheme, Ambedkar has shown his ability of flexibility as well as his strength wherever it is required. And she was concluding by showing a number of instances wherein the foresight and farsight of Ambedkar is exhibited. And finally, she concluded by indicating the scope of fundamental rights in relation to private individuals and what were the objectives or ideals of Ambedkar. And she has said that it was self-discipline, self-reformation or transformation, principle of reciprocity, and humanity, which ultimately governed Ambedkar throughout his life. Thank you so much, teacher, for the wonderful presentation.
And I
thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Actually, I am very much thankful to the LGRF for having invited me, especially Vidyut sir. Actually, I didn't want him to say I'm his guide. There is no need of guiding him, but then it's only a formality that I am a guide. So it was a very good opportunity to see the different sessions of the Constituent Assembly. Actually, otherwise, I wouldn't have looked into these documents. So you gave me an opportunity to look into these documents and to know Dr. Ambedkar more. So that is a delighting thing, because I could know him more and actually feel him more. So for that, I'm very much thankful to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Since due to the lack of time, we will be skipping the question answer session, and we will go to the felicitations. Without further ado, we will proceed, and I invite Dr. Mani Venkat Lakshman, sir, Dean School of Law at Hindustan Institute of Technology and Science. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, and it was a very excellent session. I'm very much thrilled by the presentations of Vidyut and Seema Madam. She had a very wonderful basic concepts of the constitution taken to the present level. Today we are having the 72nd Republic Day, and the travel of the constitution from its inception by Dr. Ambedkar, and the activeness of the judiciary till that is happening today has been directly or indirectly covered by her speech, by quoting the latest amendments, latest decisions, and the view of the courts and also the new legislations, reference to the directive principles, the enactments concerned. It was a very thrilling session. I was much happy and much a student to learn a lot of things which she has presented, especially regarding the constitutional debates and the views of Dr. Ambedkar, which has been very great, inspiring, and which gives the foundation to the Indian Constitution. And I don't want to extend my talk much, and I'm very happy, I'm much pleased, and I suggest that our institution should go ahead with such wonderful speeches ahead. Thank you, madam, and thank you, Vidyut, and all the team involved. And this has been a wonderful, awesome section. And we'll go along with other sessions ahead also, with discussions more on the journey of the Constitution ahead. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, all participants.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vidyut, sir.
Thank you, Manish. Now, thank you, sir. Now I invite Sri Daniel Prashant Sebastian, Managing Trustee, Madhava Mandava Science Foundation, for the felicitation.
Good evening, everybody. Am I audible enough, first of all?
Yes, sir.
Perfect. Good evening and Republic Day wishes to the distinguished guest this evening, Sri Vidyut sir, Dr. P.S. Seema ma'am, Moni Vengit sir, and our beloved associates at Team LJRF and all the friends who have joined here. It was a wonderful session by Vidyut sir and especially Seema ma'am. It was actually a fantastic walkthrough because I come from a different background altogether and an organization. It was in fact very, very good introduction as well as a deep walkthrough from the inception to till date, like Moni sir said. To quote Ambedkar again, so where he says in one of the speeches, the third thing we must do is not to be content with mere political democracy. We must note that our political democracy cannot last unless there lies in the base of its social democracy. What does social democracy mean? It means a way of life which recognizes liberty, equality, and fraternity as the principles of life. On 29th August 1947, passing one resolution, the Constituent Assembly appointed a drafting committee with 7 members, including Dr. Ambedkar, for preparing a draft of the Constitution of Independent India. It is said when drafting the Constitution of India was embarked upon, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru and Sardar Vallabhai Patel thought of inviting and consulting Sir Gore Jennings, as internationally known constitutional expert of those times. When approached for advice in that matter to Gandhiji, Gandhiji told them why they should be looking for foreign experts when they had the right man within India, an outstanding and legal constitutional expert, Dr. B. Ambedkar, who was so apt to be entrusted with a role of which he was so richly and rightly deserved. The then Law Minister, Dr. Ambedkar, was appointed as the chairman of the drafting committee. If Mahatma Gandhi gave direction and lesson of morality, then Baba Sahib Ambedkar gave shape to the social aspect without exploitation. Dr. Ambedkar was honored every step of his way. He was honored as a member of the Constituent Assembly. He was honored as the first Law Minister of the Independent India. He was honored as the chairman of the drafting committee. Because of his high, bright characteristics, as his deep and vast study, tremendous knowledge, and amazing command of an English language, expertness in explaining the subject, and ideal patriotism, he got these pleasant honors. Likewise, today, we are all witnesses of the work LJRF is doing as an organization. LJRF has such great mentors like Safi Mohan sir, eminent leaders like Tejas Purushottaman sir. We have Vishrut and Sandeep, and members who are all are well-learned, has deep and vast knowledge, and have been very passionate about the Constitution of India and the constitutional literacy as Ambedkar did in the past. We at Mandava Science Foundation wish them many success in all their future endeavors and honor come their way. As it happened for Ambedkar, may it happen for them as well.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Before we wind up the session, I invite Ms. Amina Asim, member of LJRF Trivandrum chapter and penultimate student at CSI Institute of Legal Studies, for delivering the vote of thanks. Over to you, Amina.
Thank you so much, Mr. David Varghese. So much, you have managed it well as always. Good evening to all. Basically, my duty is to deliver a vote of thanks. And we know the best and beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even touched. They must be heartfelt. Thank you is one such prayer among them. I consider it as a great privilege to propose a vote of thanks on behalf of Law and Justice Research Foundation, Trivandrum Chapter. Today is the day we Indians are proudly celebrating 72nd Republic Day. This is the day of honor. The Constitution of India came into effect by replacing Government of Indian Act. A big thanks to Law and Justice Research Foundation, Trivandrum Chapter, for conducting a wonderful session, collaborating with Mandava Science Foundation, Bangalore, and Hindustan Institute of Technology and Science, Chennai. Thank you for collaborating with us. It was indeed a pleasure. As we have a key speaker today, Dr. P.S. Seema, former director and associated professor, SLS QSAT, I, on behalf of entire fraternity, express our heartfelt thanks to you, ma'am. Thank you so much for your patience and time.
Thank you.
Initially, I would like to mention a deep sense of appreciation towards Sri Vidyut K.S., Assistant Professor, Government Law College, Kozhikode. You are a very familiar face to us, sir. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. Further,
I would like to acknowledge our gratitude to Dr. Moni Venkat Lakshman, Dean School of Law, Hindustan, Institute of Technology and Science, Chennai. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Next, I thank Sri Daniel Prashant Sebastian, Managing Trustee of Mandava Science Foundation, Bangalore. Thank you so much, sir, for your presence.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
I also take this opportunity to extend our sincere thanks to Mr. Mohan Gopal, sir, former National Judicial Academy Chairman and National Law School, Bangalore. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us throughout the session. Next, I thank Mr. Tejas Purushottaman, LJRF State President, and Ajay Yarkamar, State Secretary, of their immense support. Thank you so much. I also extend our gratitude to the strong pillar of LGRF, Mr. Safi Mohan, sir, Assistant Professor, Government Law College, Trivandrum, for his guidance. Thank you so much, sir. I must appreciate the Trivandrum Chapter officials, Mr. Chindu Joseph, President, Ms. Rose Mariam CB, Secretary, and Advocate Neelima Vinayak, Joint Secretary of LGRF Law and Justice Research Foundation, Trivandrum Chapter. Thank you so much for your hard work. Finally, and most conveniently, I convey my extreme gratitude to each and every participant who assembled here. Thank you, and I hope the session has benefited from fruitful session has benefited you all. Thank you, and happy Republic Day.
Thank you, Amina. Thank you for that word of thanks. With that, we have come to the end of our second session of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Memorial Lecture Series. Thank you all for attending. Hope you have a great night. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, teacher.